Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar, hosted by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Thank you for taking time out of your day to join us for a webinar on new habits for the new year with Jamie Gelbtuch. I'm Allie Heal, the Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's session. As a reminder, you may use the questions section of your GoToWebinar control panel on the right-hand side to submit your questions throughout the session or to let me know if you're having any technical issues. Now on to our presenter. As the founder of cultural mixology, Jamie Gelbtuch, who graduated from Georgetown College in 2001, is always looking for new and innovative ways to help people manage the complexity, uncertainty, and personal challenges presented by living or working in an international environment. She leads the strategic thinking process through coaching, training, mentoring, and consulting to support individuals and organizations that want to thrive across cultures. A cosmopolitan globetrotter, Jamie is fluent in English, Spanish, and French, with a working knowledge of Portuguese and basic Arabic. She has lived abroad and pursued her wanderlust throughout 5 continents. Without further ado, I'm pleased to turn things over to Jamie.
Thank you so much, Ali, and thank you to Georgetown Alumni Career Services for having me here today. When I was going back to prepare these slides, I was looking at previous webinars and I realized that I've been giving these for the past 12 years, which one made me feel a little bit old, but also gave me a sense of gratitude to continually be invited back. So let's get started with new habits for the new year. Ali gave me a really nice introduction, so I won't spend too much time here, but it is really nice to meet everyone. So a little bit about me. As far as connections to Georgetown, I was a French major and business and Spanish minors. I am one of the chair people in New York City for our alumni admissions program. So, you know, that conducts all of the alumni interviews, and also an emeritus member of the AAP Board of Advisors. And I'm also one of the Alumni Association career coaches. From a work perspective, as Ali said, I'm the founder of Cultural Mixology. April will be 16 years, and through Cultural Mixology, I get to do all sorts of coaching, so executive coaching, career coaching, and training for global leaders, expats, and teams. I'm an ICF credentialed coach at the PCC level. And when I'm not doing all of that, I am a runner, a meditator, and an avid traveler. So I look forward to learning a little bit more about everyone on today's call as we go through. I'm going to toggle on and off probably with my camera just to ensure that we don't have any bandwidth or internet problems, you know, as I'm going through. So I'm going to go ahead and turn that off now. And then, you know, happy to turn back on as we go through for questions and answers or things like that. So, you know, in today's webinar, what I would like to share are 5 habits, or maybe you could think of them as 5 ideas that I've picked up over the years from various places. Things I've read, people that I've worked with, chance encounters at my gym, because, you know, as the quote says here, I truly believe that we can learn something from everyone that we meet. And I want to be clear from the start that these habits or ideas are not rocket science. In fact, most of them would fall into what I like to call the simple but not easy category. And they're the kinds of ideas that make you go, well, that makes total sense. But then executing them is always a little bit trickier than it looks. What they all have in common, though, is that they've stuck with me personally as I continue to work toward my goals, and also professionally as I coach other people to work toward their goals. And they've definitely proven their worth in areas as diverse as job searches, health, wellness, fitness, entrepreneurship, networking, landing a promotion, relationships, you name it. So my hope today is that we will all continue a little bit of the lifelong learning that we started at Georgetown. By the end of this hour, you know, at least one of these ideas will also stick with you and maybe just be a game changer in reaching whatever goals you're setting for yourself this year. So just a preview of what we'll be talking about today. The first idea is that we control effort, not outcome. The second is about prioritizing energy over time. The third is that consistent can outshine constant. The fourth is about sharing the personal and guarding the private. And the fifth is just that the idea of habits can sometimes override the need for finding motivation. And I will have some questions for you related to each one as we go through, and I'll ask you to make some notes for yourself, also to participate, and you can do that, as Ali said, through the question box, not through the chat box, but through the question box. And, you know, if you're willing to participate fully, which means go grab a pen and paper, open a document on your computer or a note on your phone, then by the end, you will have the beginnings of an action plan that you can take with you today. So before we get started, I want to invite you to think of a goal that you have for 2024. And all five of the ideas I'm going to talk about can stand alone by themselves. They don't need to be tied to a goal per se, but I thought that it might make it a little more relevant to contextualize these for everyone on the call if you, you know, think of a goal that you have. So take a minute now, think of one goal. If you feel comfortable, share it in the question box, which I believe only Allie can see, so she'll be able to share those, you know, just read them out anonymously. And while you're doing that, I just want to say a few words about goals. And I want to acknowledge firstly that some people may be coming into today without a goal or not knowing what their goal is, and that's perfectly fine. So if you're thinking about what you might want your goal to be this year, it could help to think of the fact that when there's a gap, there's a goal. So if you're here and you want to be there, you can look at that gap and think about what the goal might be. Another thing about goals is that we always want them to be positive and not negative. So one thing I hear a lot is, I want to stop working so late this year. But I would invite you to think not about what you want to stop doing, but rather what you want to start doing. So if you weren't working late and you had that time free, what would you be doing with it? Maybe you would be going to the gym. Maybe you would be having dinner with your family, right? So the goal then is really, I want to go to the gym 3 nights per week after work, or I want to have dinner with my family 3 nights per week. And then we can go even further, right? We can think about the goal behind the goal. So if we stick with the example of going to the gym 3 nights per week, you know, what would you have in your life that you don't have now? How would that be a benefit to you? How would your life be better, right? Maybe you want to feel more energized, participate more easily in sports with your kids. Maybe you want to have a fitter physique, right? So kind of looking at the goal behind the goal. So if you feel comfortable sharing in the question box, please write in, share what your goal is. And Allie, if anybody shared, maybe you could share those with us in case it sparks any thinking for someone else.
Yeah, I'm happy to. We had three come in. One was to be present. Another was to get a new job. Mm-hmm. And the most recent was to move to a new city.
Great. I'm just making a note of those. Great. And if any others come in, you know, feel free to share. And if you don't share, just jot it down for yourself and use that as we go through.
So we got one more, right? If you want me to read it.
Absolutely.
Being more intentional and strategic with my time.
Got it. That's a good one. All of these are good. More strategic and intentional with time. Yep. Okay. Good. So let's get started with the first idea. And the first one I want to talk about is the fact that we control effort, not outcome. And this one has been drilled into my head by my mentor coach. And yes, I'm a coach who also has a coach, but it's not her original idea. It's based on largely on the work that's been done by Carol Dweck. That name might ring a bell if you've ever read anything about fixed versus growth mindsets. She's one of the leading researchers on that topic and just what motivates people in general. And I think it's fair to say that so many of us are deeply invested in the outcomes of whatever it is that we're working on. And why wouldn't we be, right? I mean, it's totally natural to want success, to want to achieve positive results, right? And if I think about your goals, to want to get to that new city, get that new job, be more present, be more intentional with our time, of course, we want to achieve those things. But one of the keys to sustainable growth in any area is really our ability to shift from just being focused on the result to also being process oriented. And I'll give you an example maybe about the getting the new job, right? So imagine you or someone or whichever of our participants today listed that as a goal, who's searching for a job, and you send out tons of tailored resumes, right? You work with the ATS system, you put in all the keywords, you tirelessly network, you enlist the help of a mentor or coach, but the job offer still doesn't come as quickly as you hope. And despite all of your efforts, right, there are external factors. Maybe it's industry fluctuations, a bad economy, competitive job market in the city you're living that can impact the outcome of landing that job. So controlling effort in this context or this example means that you continue to enhance your skills. You continue to keep networking, you keep pursuing opportunities, even when you're faced with rejection. It means adding the word yet to the end of your sentences, right? I haven't identified the right role yet. I haven't had that offer I want yet. And it also means accepting that it's okay for something to feel hard. I worked with a running coach a few years ago, and I would always complain during the workouts that it felt so hard. And he said, you know, Jamie, it's supposed to feel hard. Why wouldn't this feel hard? You're challenging yourself. So, you know, controlling effort means continuing to look for new ways. What ideas haven't I thought of? Who haven't I connected with? What other companies are out there? What other job search websites are out there, right? That's part of that growth mindset and the things that are within our control. Embracing the outcome means acknowledging that a lot of those external factors I mentioned, right, market conditions or a company's priorities or unforeseen circumstances can influence the final result. And just because that result doesn't come as quickly as we want, doesn't mean that the efforts we're putting forth aren't valuable. So it's really normal to be stressed about our goals. I think we all know that telling someone, don't be stressed out or you'll get a new job really soon, doesn't work. But what generally does work for all of us is figuring out what we can control and focusing on that. So my question for you now is, you know, in thinking about the goal you shared on the previous slide, what are three things that you can control when working towards your goal? And, you know, I'd ask you to write them down for yourself. And if you're willing, maybe share one or two of them in the chat box. And Allie, if we get any responses, then it would be great to hear them.
Yeah. We'll give folks a few seconds just to respond and type into that question section. As Jamie said, we did also get a few more goals come in after we had moved on, centered around being healthier, focusing on mental health, et cetera.
Great. Thank you for sharing those.
Yeah. So as they come in, I'll just go ahead and read them out. Not necessarily related to the specific goal maybe that they had mentioned, but my attitude. Is something that you can control.
And that's great. We don't even need to know which goals they're related to. It's more just kind of sharing so that we can all get a sense of some things we can control, maybe which we hadn't thought of, which someone else had.
someone else said, I can control how I spend my time, my reaction and mindset.
Those are great.
Don't see any more for right now. So,
Well, I love that. You know, a lot of those are related to, I feel like, the stories we tell ourselves, right? Like our attitude, how we show up, how we make choices to use our time. All of those are things that we can control. And, you know, it's perfectly fine if you hadn't shared, note it down for yourself. I'm going to send these slides out, or Ali will after, so you'll be able to go back through as well if you want to kind of work it through when you have a little bit more time. So I know that a few of the things that have been mentioned so far are about being intentional and strategic with our time. And so that leads us very nicely into the second idea, which is prioritizing energy over time. And this is an idea that's, you know, been written about in many places. One of the most known ones is the book, The Power of Full Engagement by Jim Lehrer and Tony Schwartz. And, you know, every day has a fixed number of hours, right? That's just the facts. And there is a strong place for time management. But no matter how well we manage our time, we just can't create more of it. So sometimes it's helpful to think about what we can influence or what we can control to build off number one, which is the quality of energy that we bring to the time that we have. So, you know, one thing I hear a lot is I don't get enough sleep, right? I can only get 5 or 6 hours of sleep a night. I really want to get 8 hours. And there's a place for time management there. We might be able to change something about our schedules, and that would be ideal. But if we can't, if some of that is beyond our control, meaning, you know, particular phase of a work project that we're in or family obligations, and we really just can't sleep more, my question is always, can we sleep better? So can we adjust our nighttime routine or food, you know, or what we do when we get into bed, right, to get a better 6 hours of sleep if we can't get 8? And maybe that means when we get into bed for those 6 hours, we make the intentional choice to turn off our phone so that doesn't, you know, suck more energy away from us. Or maybe we get into bed and we do a 3-minute wind down meditation so that we can at least get a better 6 hours if we can't get the 8. Another thing here, and this kind of links to what some people said in terms of controlling attitude and mindset, is can we question the stories that we tell ourselves about time and maybe tell ourselves a different one? So we might say, I'm not a morning person. This is actually something I say a lot, so that's probably why I'm using it as the example. But could we tell ourselves a different story? Could we say, I'm learning how to get up a little bit earlier? Because if I maybe get up 10 minutes earlier, I can do something that gives me a little more energy in my day. Maybe I can have 10 minutes of, you know, just peace and quiet, or 10 minutes to take a walk outside or to read a few pages in a book, right? And so the energy that we can get from those 10 minutes can become more important than, you know, the 10 minutes themselves. I'm sure we can all think of a day when we felt really energized and productive, and we can think of what helped that happen. And we can all think of a day when we felt drained and unproductive, and we can think of what made that happen. Sometimes it's going to be unpredictable, right? No matter how much, back to point one, we control the effort, unexpected things will happen. So can we identify things that will give us energy even when things don't go as planned? We know that peak performance is not just a result of effective time management, but it's really also about effective energy management. And so my question for you here is, when you think about your goal, what's one way or one thing you can do to increase your energy level when working towards it? So what are some things for you that you know replenish you or give you a little bit of energy no matter how small or big. So I'll give you a minute to type it into that question box. And Allie, if we get any answers, then I'd love to hear them.
Sure thing. We had one come in quick, working out and volunteering.
Yep.
Another one is getting outside. Walking.
And something that I like, you know, about those answers, and we're going to talk about this actually on the next slide, is just that, you know, those things can be as small or as big as we want. It might be that we take an hour walk, but some days we might just have 5 minutes to go out and walk around the block. Sometimes I do that. I live in New York City, and I'll just literally have a little space between clients, and I'll go outside and just circle my block one time, just to get that fresh air and kind of revive that energy. Same thing with working out. Sometimes it can be an hour at the gym, and sometimes it's literally just 10 minutes. So all of those things can be done on different scales.
Another one that came in is including stretch breaks while doing desk work.
So good, right? Like for every hour that you're sitting, just making sure to get up at some point, like move your body, walk around. Yep. Great idea. Anything else that's come in?
Nothing at the moment, but I'll keep an eye on it and can raise them as we move on.
Perfect. So I love how these are all kind of nicely leading into the next one based on some of the answers, right? And so the third idea that I think about a lot is that consistent can outshine constant. And the distinction between these two words is something that resonated, came from Chris Bennett, who's the Nike Running Global Head Coach. Most days when I run, I listen to the Nike Run Club app, and I'm a huge fan of Coach Bennett. A lot of people say he's like the real life version of Ted Lasso. I was even lucky enough to take a course with him 2 summers ago called Best Runner Ever, which I highly recommend. And in one of his guided runs, he pulls out the dictionary like he so often does, and he makes this distinction between the idea of constantly and consistently. And we often think when we have a goal, we have to be working on it constantly, right? Meaning all the time. So if we're searching for a job and we're not working at the time, we might feel as if we need to spend all day, every day working on it. Or if we're searching for a job when we already have a job, we might feel as if we need to spend every free moment on the job search. And what Coach Bennett talks about is how it's more important, even necessary, to be consistent rather than constant. Because consistent, it implies irregularity, so it's not an excuse to not do something, but it also gives us flexibility, right? And again, I kind of go back to that first idea, is that, you know, things are going to pop up that are beyond our control. So we might plan to spend 3 hours doing research for that new city we want to move to, and something may come up that day. We may be sick. Our kids may be home from school. We may just not be in the mood, right? And so maybe that day, instead of 3 hours, all we can bring ourselves to give is 30 minutes. And so that's what we give. That's our 100% for that day. And if on another day we can give 3 hours, then that's what we give. And again, this isn't an excuse to give less or to do less, but it's more like giving ourselves permission to understand that things are going to vary, right? Consistently can take on many different forms. So for some people in goals, it may mean twice a week. For others, it might mean 5 minutes a day. I meditate every day when I wake up, but I do it generally for like 3 minutes. There are some days I do 10, there are some days I do 20, but I use the Headspace app, I usually pick like the 3 minute version because that's what enables me to make it a habit and to be consistent about it. So sometimes, you know, we wanna start as small as necessary to start building the habit and to start getting it into our routine. So I'm particularly interested in the answer to this question about what consistency looks like for you when working toward your goal. You know, how often will you dedicate time to it, frequency, the duration? Because I want to hear, and I want everyone on the call to hear, the range of what consistency might mean. So if you're willing to share what consistency means for you, like how often you'll be spending time on this goal, please share it in the question box. And then, you know, Allie, please share with the group.
Sure, happy to. For the person who wrote getting outside, they said their goal is 20 minutes outside a day, every day. And that is their version of consistent.
Great.
I'll quickly just interject while we're waiting for some more responses to come in. Jamie, I also love the Nike Running Club. It's wonderful and motivational and fantastic. We did have someone else. Oh, go ahead.
No, I was going to say one thing I love about it, just to underscore this point, you know, so for me, consistency generally means running 5 days a week, but what that looks like on all of the days is different. And like, there are some days when I can run for an hour, and then there are other things, not to promote the Nike Run Club app, no affiliation, but like, there are, you know, runs in there that are literally 2 minutes, 4 minutes, 9 minutes, 12 minutes, and they're all valid. They're all part of being consistent. Is just being flexible with what you can give that day.
Someone else had written in workout twice a week, so kind of in that same vein.
Great. Just give another minute in case anybody else wants to share.
I don't see any. I can keep an eye on the chat as well and read some of those out toward the end if we have time as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So again, like if you're doing this at home, you know, just think about what's the frequency, what's the duration, like what's the goal of what that consistency will look like for you. Okay, so the fourth idea, share the personal, guard the private. And this was something I picked up that was inspired by the wisdom of a German expat client. It's not surprisingly deeply rooted in the German value of privacy. And before I talk about how it applies, let me explain a little bit more about, you know, the meaning behind it. So I'm going to use a metaphor. Think about inviting people into your home, right? So imagine you're getting together with people, and rather than go out to a restaurant, you know, you want to be a little more personal. So you invite people into your home. You're sharing that part of your world. And while we may invite guests over, usually not every room is open to everybody, right? So we're probably not going to have our guests going into our bedroom closet, for example, right? So we're kind of delineating between how we can be personal, but still guard the private. And I think this is really relevant today because unless our job is based on being an influencer, in which case this is not going to apply to you, I think a lot of us struggle with how we can make it a habit to share enough of our personal and professional worlds with people to build connection and receive support while not putting it all out there, right? Like, you know, think of your LinkedIn profile, like how much detail do I want to put? How much do I want to write about myself? How many things should I share, right? Like what's the right amount so that I can build an online brand and, you know, build connection and get support. But it's not about constructing a facade, right? But it's more about being intentional with what we choose to share. So let's take an obvious example. Suppose you just got a promotion at work, right? So you might go on LinkedIn, share this accomplishment, express gratitude for the support you've received. Maybe you highlight some of the lessons that you learned. All of this is really good personal sharing. It allows your network to celebrate with you. It gives a glimpse into your professional journey. But at the same time, most of us are going to do some private guarding, right? We're probably not gonna share in that post specific details about our salary or the office politics, the other person that really wanted the job that we got, right? Things about the company strategies or changes you're planning to implement, right? All of that is information that's best kept private. So, you know, whether your audience is a social media, you know, following on a platform, or your audience is your team or your company or your industry or your family, it's helpful to think about how can you maintain and build connection by sharing some personal things without compromising the integrity of your private space, right? So when you think about the goals that you're working towards, you know, just think for yourself, which parts of this process, you know, can you share with other people so that, you know, you can get that support and build connection? And then which parts are just for yourself that you might want to keep private? So, you know, if you, for example, are making that practice of getting outside and walking for 20 minutes, I don't know if you're that person is, you know, in an office or in a neighborhood at home, but, you know, could it be helpful to share that goal with the people around you? Maybe someone else in your office or a neighbor says, you know what, let me know when you're going. I'd love to do that too. And that helps build connection, or maybe it helps motivate you to go. But then maybe there are other parts of our goals that, you know, we choose to guard. So Allie, if anybody has shared, you know, the answer to this question in the question box, let us know.
I will keep an eye on it, and we'll give folks just a bit to respond.
Absolutely. I'm just thinking of the goals that people shared, right? So, you know, moving to a new city. So when I think of that, there are probably lots of parts of that process that are helpful to share, you know, like with our network so that we can get recommendations and resources. But then there are probably parts that are like a little bit more private. I don't know, it could be like our budget for like our new house, or, you know, any, I don't know if there were any internal family fights related to the move or, you know, things like that. So just trying to think of some of the, you know, the goals you mentioned and how that could play out.
That's a great example. Also, someone wrote in, it was the person who said that they wanted to get a new job. Mm-hmm. They said, work on my resume with a certified resume consultant. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's great. And, you know, even after you get that initial draft, you know, some people like to share that with a few trusted people in the industry they're targeting so that they can get some feedback, right? So that that's a great thing to share with some people in your network. So,
no other ones right now, Jamie.
Yeah, that's fine. And, you know, obviously, no, don't share the parts that you want to keep private, because the whole idea there is to keep them private. So, but again, just make some notes for yourself. And then the last idea that I want to share here, maybe it's going to be a little controversial, I don't know, but it's the idea that sometimes just having habits can override the need for motivation. And this insight hit me during, I think I mentioned that unexpected chat at the gym when we started. That's why the source of this one is just girl at my gym. And it was last September, just after taking a week off from workouts post Labor Day, and getting back into my workout routine felt really, really tough. And there was this girl, Paulina, who was consistently crushing her routine, like the Energizer Bunny. And Paulina and I are not friends. I wouldn't even say we're gym buddies. I would say we're more like familiar faces. And we always give each other kind of like a silent acknowledgement, because our workout hours tend to coincide. So we'll wave to each other or we'll say hi. And During that week, I was struggling. I was intrigued, or more likely envious and frustrated at her seemingly perpetual motivation. So I went over to her and I asked, "Do you ever just not feel motivated to be here?" And her response was a bit of a game changer for me. I thought about this few minute interaction for weeks afterwards because she said, "Absolutely." She said, "For me, working out has become more of a habit than about motivation." She said, "It's like brushing my teeth. Like, do I really feel motivated to brush my teeth, or do I just do it out of habit because it's a good thing to do?" She said, "That's what working out is like for me. I wake up, I brush my teeth, I go to the gym." And it just got me thinking, like a light bulb went off in my head, because I spend a lot of time as a coach, you know, focusing on people's motivation, purpose, helping people identify that. And they're critical, there's no doubt. I'm not minimizing that in any way. But sometimes I wonder if we put just a little too much weight on finding motivation when there are certain things that are just good habits to cultivate, and that is reason enough. Like, we don't particularly think about, you know, the motivation every time we put on our seatbelt or brush our teeth. I mean, yes, there's a deep-seated motivation there, right? We want to be safe in an accident. We want to have healthy teeth. But there are more things that we do out of habit. And so if we know something is good for us, like fitness, you know, and wellness, can we just say, "I'm doing this because it's a good habit," and that is reason enough? So, you know, my question here for you is, what is one habit related to your goals? So, you know, related to being more strategic and intentional with time, or focusing on your mental health, or being present, or getting that new job. What's one habit you need to adopt to reach your goal? And Allie, obviously, anything that comes in, please share.
I'll keep an eye on it. None yet.
Okay.
Okay. For the person who wrote in that they wanted to prioritize mental health and just overall well-being, one habit is to practice mindfulness while brushing my teeth.
I love that. I feel like I read that in a book somewhere, just to focus on every tooth as you're brushing. And I tried that a few times. I thought it was really, really interesting, and a great way to be present.
Another person had written in calendar time for it. So if it's walking, for example, block off calendar time to do so.
And that's a great habit. A lot of times we only block things for, you know, like work obligations or family obligations, but we don't block that time for our own, you know, health, wellness, presence. So I love the idea of just blocking off the time, even just to take a walk.
Someone else wrote in, follow up with initial efforts and move forward, even if obstacles are encountered.
Mm-hmm. Persistence, resilience, growth mindset, right? Absolutely. Like, I haven't heard back yet. I'm going to follow up again. Mm-hmm. Great. So I'll move forward just for the purposes of time, but if anything else comes in, Allie, feel free to jump in. And, you know, I want to bring this a little bit full circle for people. So taking all of your goals into account and thinking about the idea of an action plan, you know, it's usually our default to start with a do, right? And that's a lot of what we've talked about today, right? What do I need to do? I need to be mindful while brushing my teeth. I need to send follow-ups. I need to walk for 20 minutes. And so we think if we do this, then we'll have that, and then we'll be successful at our goal. So to take another example that I hear a lot, like people say, I want to grow my professional network more this year. So it might look like this, right? If we start with a do, I need to attend events, make cold calls, send LinkedIn requests in order to have more sales leads, and then I'll be successful at reaching my sales goal this year. Or a personal example might be, I want to do 30 minutes of cardio every day so I have a fitter physique and then I will be happy. And so there's naturally a big focus on the doing, right? And what we need to do in these examples to reach our goals. But I'd like to ask you to switch the paradigm a little bit and think about who you need to be successful at moving to a new city, being more present, right? Getting a new job, or whatever it is, you know, that's your goal that you've been thinking about during your time together today. So if I take the previous example about growing our network, maybe it sounds more like I need to be open, approachable, knowledgeable in order to build a strong network, which means attending events, making cold calls, all the doing things, and then ultimately have greater financial stability, which is generally what we want if we're trying to, you know, achieve our sales goal. So this brings us full circle now, because when we focus on cultivating the B, these attributes become more sustainable and enduring. We expand our vision of ourselves and what we believe is possible. In the first idea, I said we control effort, not outcome. We may not always get that result that we want. And believe me, I work with people all the time to set them up for success and help them work toward whatever goal they have. But if we don't make it to that new city, or we don't get exactly the job that we want, or we don't manage our time exactly as we want, even without that result, can we still have had a transformational journey by showing up in a certain way, right? By being committed, by being open, by being knowledgeable, whatever your B words are. So now that we've outlined a little bit about what you want to do, my last question for you today is, what are your being words? So for whatever goal you shared, who do you need to be to make that happen? So go ahead, write that into the question box. And then Allie, last time to maybe share out people's words.
Committed.
Mm-hmm.
Focused. Another mm-hmm. committed seems to be a popular one. Motivated.
Mm-hmm. And what I love about, you know, focusing on the B is that even when we don't know what to do, the B tells us what to do. So if we say to ourselves, I don't know what else to do in my job search, but our word is committed, we can just ask ourselves, if I'm really committed to getting a new job, what would I do right now? If I'm really going to be motivated, what would I do right now? And so we can always come back to those words to help us figure out what we need to do.
Accepting was another one that just came in.
Great word. Mm-hmm.
And that's it for right now.
Yeah, thank you. So, you know, the thought that I want to leave people with is sometimes when we think about the idea of habits and goals, we think a lot about disciplined, and that might be one of your being words. I mean, that may apply to your particular goal. But if we just think about kind of how we want to show up in general toward working on things, right? It's not always a question of discipline. It's a question of habits. What can we work into our routine so that it just becomes automatic? And then how can we use discipline like a tool to, you know, cement those habits for ourselves? So with that, I want to thank everyone for their participation and sharing today. And I'm happy to spend a few minutes. I know we're right at 12:45, if there are any questions.
Thank you so much, Jamie. For anyone who has questions, please go ahead and write them into that question panel that we've been using throughout today's session. We did have one question come in while the presentation was going on. If you feel like you have multiple goals, how do you decide on one to focus on to get started?
Important question. So I think then it becomes a question of priorities. The goals might be in different areas of your life, and it's okay to have more than one goal. But I would say that really we want to prioritize and see which is the most important and then start with that. And, you know, there may be some kind of exercises you can go through, in order to figure that out, to rate, you know, how well this fits with your future plans, how well this fits with your strengths. I usually have a little exercise that I walk people through so you can really see you're saying it's a goal, but if you compare it with your other goals, how would they fall out in terms of ranking? And you can just do a little bit of assessment that way. But bottom line, it's about prioritizing.
Great, thank you. We had another question come in. Can you work on multiple goals but chip away on all of them with small steps? For example, if my goals are related to sleep, nutrition, and exercise, they support a larger well-being goal, so we can put them together.
Absolutely. I'm just going to turn on my camera maybe for the Q&A. Yes, absolutely. And in those three that were mentioned, I think they all will feed off of each other, because nutrition can help promote better sleep. And, you know, when we sleep better, we have fewer cravings for things that aren't healthy for us. So especially in that genre of goals, I think they all work really nicely together. But absolutely, breaking it down into like these really small steps makes it even more likely that we can work on multiple areas at once, because we're not overwhelming ourselves with like one massive idea of things, something that needs to change, and another massive idea. So yes.
Do you have a recommended method for tracking your goals? Some people suggest writing them down. Wasn't sure if you had any other suggestions.
So if it's about tracking the goals, like the like what you're working toward, then yes, I think you can, you can break it down. I would break each thing down into as small as it needs to, like finding a job, right? That's the goal, but it's actually the result. The goal is probably update your resume, update your LinkedIn, have X number of networking conversations per week, send X number of job applications. So all of those micro goals are going to get you to the bigger goal, or essentially the result. So kind of breaking it down in that way. And I've probably mentioned this in past webinars, or if you know me, you've heard me talk about it, but I'm also a big fan of the to-done list, not the to-do list, but the to-done list. And so working toward any goal, once you accomplish a piece of it, keep track for yourself somewhere, right? Don't just cross it off like, okay, updated my resume, put that on your to-done list, so that then on the days when you're feeling like I'm not making any progress, go back and look, remind yourself, well, that's not true. I updated my resume. I've had 10 networking calls this month. I've sent 20 applications, right? So also track what you've accomplished in addition to the steps that you need to get there.
That's great. Thank you so much, Jamie. We don't have any other questions right now, but what I will recommend to everyone on the line today, please reach out to Jamie with any questions that you didn't have a chance to ask. Her contact information will be included in the follow-up email. Jamie, anything to add before we wrap up?
No, I just want to say thank you to everyone for participating. I'm always happy to connect with fellow Hoyas, so please feel free to reach out. I'll send the slides to Allie, and I just wish everyone good luck with whatever you are pursuing in 2024.
Thank you so much, Jamie, and we really appreciate you taking the time to share your insights and your expertise with our alumni community. To everyone who joined today, thank you. Please look out for that follow-up email, which will include Jamie's contact information, the slide deck, as she mentioned, as well as a recording of today's session and a calendar of our upcoming programs. Thanks again for joining, everyone, and Hoya Saxa.